Welcome into this edition of Under the Lights, driven by Chevy. I'm Scott Klatzkin here with interim head coach Dennis Dottin-Carter. The show has changed. As earlier in this week, it was announced that Coach Brock, after 3.5 seasons, was relieved of his duties as head coach of the Blue Hens. Now, everyone that has been around this Delaware program for some time over the last 3.5 seasons knows that Coach Brock was a great guy, a great family man. He brought in great students to this university and a lot of talented players. He checked off every box that needed to be checked off in what you're looking for as a head coach. The only box that maybe was left blank was compiling the amount of wins necessary at this university, and unfortunately, he was let go earlier in the week. Coach, you're tasked with taking over the Hens at this point in the season, and we'll talk football, we'll talk X's and O's, but first, I know Coach Brock meant a whole lot to you.
Yeah, Coach Brock was an amazing person, human being. The thing that made me gravitate to him the most was just how strongly he felt about the players. You know, he, without a doubt, made them his first priority. He wanted them to have the best possible experience that they could have here at the University of Delaware. He felt that the University of Delaware was a first-class institution. He thought that we could do a great job here, and that was his number one job, and I think he did a great job with it. The players loved him. They love him still. You know, as I've said before, they feel indebted to him. We all are indebted to him for everything he's done, whether it be just hiring us here at the University of Delaware. And on top of that, there are things that no one's going to know about that he's done for us as a staff. You know, so I am extremely, I am in his debt, and I am extremely, thoughtful of him. I want to do a great job. I want to make sure that, we obviously win games. But I want to keep intact all the right things that he's done.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, in the bottom line business of college football, coaches are going to be hired, coaches are going to be fired all the time. When it happens inside of a season, though, it can be difficult to make that transition for the coaches, for the staff, and certainly for the players. What's your message to the players this week leading up to the game on Saturday?
My message to the players is going to be simple. Things have changed. You know, we have constantly, since we've gotten here, talked about being together. You know, together we will has been our team mantra, and I'm not going to change that. You know, we need to stay together. It didn't matter whether we were undefeated or where we are right now. You know, at 2-4, it doesn't matter what the circumstance is. You got to play the next play, and the only way you're going to win anything that you do is together. You know, it's a team sport, one of the biggest team sports around. You know, 11 guys all at one time, and you need the guys who aren't on the field to be with you. You know, everyone needs to be dialed in. Everyone needs to be committed. And I think this group of young men is a resilient group. I have been thoroughly impressed at how well they've dealt with this. We are certainly moving forward. The goal is to beat Stony Brook on Saturday. They're going to give us a huge test. We know that. We are prepared to go out and prepare for a really, really, really good football team. And we are prepared to go out and do that together.
All right. Well, I appreciate you doing this show. I'm sure this is the first time that you've been able to sit still for quite some time, certainly since Sunday and your conversation with Chrissy. Describe the whirlwind that has been your week so far.
I think the biggest thing is just the volume of information now that I'm getting. You know, a whirlwind is a great way to describe it. You know, I'm just getting all the knowledge that Coach Brock had, and you got to deal with it. You know, it's nonstop. There are so many different venues you got to put yourself in. You know, when people know academics and you know football. There's also athletic training. There's also strength and conditioning. You know, and then there's so many behind the scenes things that either involve the players or don't involve the players that you got to take care of. You know, and everyone kind of knows that the head coach has more responsibilities, but you never really know until you're there. So I mean, that's been the biggest thing. Again, the volume of information, and then obviously trying to balance my football duties. You know, I certainly have not had the opportunity to do as much as I've been doing. But I mean, like I said before, we have a great staff, an unbelievable staff, defensively and offensively. I put my faith in those guys. And we'll move forward from there.
Well, let's talk about some of those duties that you had as defensive line coach and defensive coordinator. And Coach Brock, not only head coach, but he worked with the quarterbacks as well. He was the quarterback coach. So how will you slide some of the responsibilities throughout the staff?
Yeah, so I mean, it's kind of a tough dynamic, obviously, with Coach Brock coaching the quarterbacks. You lose him, you lose the quarterbacks coach. You promote a guy, now you kind of lose another position. You almost lost two position coaches with one move. But again, Mike Bamonte has done a tremendous job since he's been here. I have full confidence in him. Coach Devine has full confidence in him. Obviously, Coach Devine is going to, he'll oversee the whole operation. But again, you know, Mike has, Mike is a very intelligent young man, and the players gravitate to him. The players, you know, they respond to him. So I have faith in him to be able to get the job done. All you know, right. Defensively, on the defensive line, again, Coach Lott's been here for 2 years. He's been in the system. He knows what we want to do. He's got a great relationship with the players. You know, so I think they'll respond to him as well. Again, he's not going to take over the full duties of the defensive line, but he certainly will help us out.
Well, let's talk some football, because you're coming off of a loss against William & Mary on Saturday on the road, a game in which you led 14-3 against the Tribe at Zabel Stadium. Once that was the score, there was an interception in the red zone, and William & Mary was able to start on their 20, drive 80 yards, 11 plays, an excellent drive. They didn't face a third down until late in that drive. Then the onside kick, and then a 10-play, 54-yard drive to get the lead in the hands of William & Mary, kind of just like that. But with all of that, your defense was on the field for 9 minutes and 59 seconds of game clock, actual time much longer. Do you feel like when you defend against an 80-yard drive, onside kick, and you're right back out there, the defense might have been a little gassed at that point?
Yeah, I wouldn't use the term gassed. And the reason why is because I think we do a really, really good job of rotating the guys through. Mm-hmm. You know, on the defensive line, we're rotating those guys through, you know, constantly. You know, if a play is going longer than five plays, if a drive is going longer than five plays, you know we're gonna get those guys in and out. And obviously there are personnel substitutions based on down and distance. You know, and I think we do a really, really good job going from drive to drive, substituting in the defensive backfield and at the linebacker level. So I would not say that, you know, gas would not be a term I would use. And I think our team is in really, really good condition as well. Yeah. I never feel like we come off the field, even after an 80-yard drive, even after a 10-play drive, a 15-play drive. I never feel like we come off the field and we're just dead. I don't ever feel like that. I always feel like we're ready to go back on the field, no matter when that time may be. It may be the very next play because of a turnover. It may be in 15 plays because of a great drive. I always feel like we're ready to play the next drive. You know, and at the end of the day, you know, we put it on those guys. They need to get off the field. We need to get off the field. Mm-hmm. We need to make the calls that get us off the field, and we need to make the plays that get us off the field. You know, every week we take a look at the film, and there's always going to be some plays. You know, you hope not, and you hope this week it won't be the same. But so far, there'll always be plays where you look and say, hey, if we just made this one play, if we, you know, beat this one block, if we fit this one gap correctly, we could have gotten off the field. And, you know, they know that. They know we've got to get off the field. We certainly don't blame the interception in the end zone. They had to drive 80 yards, you know, and we talk about making offenses earn everything that they get. Clearly, we don't want them to get anything, but if they do get something, we want it to be earned. And you know, we did give up some yards that weren't earned. So, you know, gassed, I would not say that, no. And we certainly know we need to get off the field.
Okay, let's talk about the offense, because interceptions were thrown against William & Mary, and that's uncommon trait for this team. The team, going back to last season to start this year, had gone 100 passes without throwing an interception. There was the one in the red zone, and then unfortunately, 2 weeks in a row now, the game kind of ends with a defensive player running back into the end zone. What did you see on those interceptions? Where were the breakdowns?
Well, you know, the first interception, the one in the end zone, that was a coaching error. You know, we shouldn't have called that play. You know, Coach Devine has owned that. He has said, he wished he ran the ball. Obviously, in hindsight, we wish we would have run the ball. But, you know, run game's going well. We made the call. And then at the end of the day, you know, we still didn't execute the play correctly. You know, there's always, you know, there was the execution issue. So we can go back and say, you know, we shouldn't have called the play. But if it was a touchdown, we wouldn't be sitting there saying we shouldn't have called that play.
Right.
Exactly. And then, you know, on the second interception, it was a miscommunication between the quarterback and the receiver. That's what it comes down to. It's tough. And that particular play, the coverage they were playing, and you know, that spot on the field, it turns out to be a pick six, you know, and it's unfortunate. We obviously were put in a tough position, but you know, those miscommunications happen. It could have happened earlier in the game, and we probably wouldn't be talking about it as much right now, but at the point in time that it happened, it's very significant.
Well, a chance to bounce back this week against Stony Brook, and it's good to be home. You'll have back-to-back home games for the first time this season starting on Saturday. So we're going to talk about Stony Brook. First time Delaware will be playing Stony Brook in conference competition, but we'll take a timeout. We come back down and back with Grant Roberts, a guy that you know, I'm sure, very well from the defensive line. So we'll hear from him, and then we'll hear about Stony Brook. You're watching Under the Lights, driven by Chevy.
Welcome.
How you doing?
Thanks for coming. Today you're going to choose a mobile office to drive to a remote work site.
Okay.
You can choose this Chevy Silverado that offers built-in 4G LTE Wi-Fi, or you can choose this Ford F-150 that doesn't offer Wi-Fi. But to make up for it, we added a trailer, a satellite antenna, and Dolores.
Hey, fellas.
Technology's a little behind in here.
Now, the Silverado offers built-in Wi-Fi with a connection that's stronger than your smartphone.
Slick.
So which one do you want?
I'd pick the Chevy.
Silverado.
It leaves Ford in the dust.
It just can't beat it.
Little details. Truly a game of inches. Small things people don't see. It's about putting yourself in the best position. It starts here. The work isn't flashy. It's not glamorous, but it's necessary. Because after all, the future is now.
Welcome to another edition of Down and Back. I'm Andrew Wickman, this time alongside Grant Roberts. Grant, we're going to get to know you a little bit better today. How's that sound?
Sounds great.
Cool. All right, first question. What does it mean to wear the blue and gold after being from Delaware?
It means a lot, you know, to be able to be close to home, play for my home university, have my family come out and see me play games. It feels great.
So other than playing for Delaware, what does it mean to be at Delaware on campus?
It's great. I love the university. You know, it's fun. The academic side of it is a big part for me, which is part of the reason why I chose to come here, you know, so it's good.
Cool. So going with that academic side, what has been your favorite class or favorite professor?
I would say Edgar Johnson, actually, was probably my favorite professor in my intro to sport management class.
Why is that?
He taught the class a lot because sports management is what I want to do. So he taught the class a lot about the ins and outs of the sport industry, and he was a athletic director here, so it was great to learn from him.
All right, so you said sports management is what you want. I saw that you wanted to be a GM. Do you have a particular sport you want to be a GM in? Obviously, football could be favor.
Definitely football, but, you know, if I could work in any sport, I've grown to like a lot of the other sports, especially soccer. I've grown to like soccer a lot more recently. So, you know, any sport, really, but a GM definitely for football.
Cool. So any other sports that you play, if you weren't to play football, what would be the other sport?
Other sport, basketball, probably.
Yeah?
You know, I'm pretty good.
Nice.
Got a good jump shot.
Oh, yeah. Ball is that
bit.
Right?
Yeah, pretty good.
All right, so going back up to campus, what has been your favorite memory while being at Delaware?
Probably my first sack.
Yeah?
Yeah. Here.
Against who?
Elon, my red shirt freshman year. You know, it was a great feeling to finally get the first one. Yeah.
That's awesome. And how about up on campus?
Probably the first semester I got over a 3-0. You know, I struggled a little bit at first, but, you know, I was able to pick it up.
Cool.
Academic-wise.
What were your season goals heading into this season, and do you still have them? Have you changed?
My season goals were just to be a better player, be, you know, better technique-wise, also be a leader on the field, you know, for the younger players, just be all-around better player.
All right, we'll go with a fun question here. What is your guilty pleasure?
I really love, like, Gushers and bacon.
Oh, yes.
They're definitely not good for you, but definitely two of my favorite foods.
How about a guilty pleasure song that you listen to before a game or just in general?
Before a game? Self Control by Frank Ocean is one of the new songs that I've been listening to recently. You know, it's not really a usual hype song before a game, but you know, I definitely listen to it.
All right, if there was a talent show held right now with the whole football team, would you win? Or if not, which one of your teammates would win and with what?
I probably definitely wouldn't win because I don't have a talent. I don't know who will win. Maybe Jethro, since he can juggle, obviously. Thistle's pretty good at singing. He plays the guitar. No, one of those two, definitely not me.
So heading into the second half of the season, what are you guys looking for?
We're just looking to compete hard, you know, come out and win all the games we want to know each week. You know, conference play is coming up, so each game is going to be tough. But we should be able to win every single one of them.
How about you? What are you looking for to do?
I'll just keep producing, you know, keep being a good teammate, keep being a leader, keep being able to, you know, provide leadership for the young guys and, you know, helping the team win.
Awesome. Well, thank you, Grant. We really appreciate getting
to
know you a little better. For Hens All Access, this has been another Down and Back. I'm Andrew Wickman. We'll see you next time.
They end 2015 with a road victory over Elon.
Our season ended at 2:55. At 2:56, a new season began. But we can't just talk about it. We've got to be about it. On the field, no one's spot is guaranteed. And in here, excuses don't matter. I'm going to work harder and longer than I ever have. Check your feelings at the door, because the bar has been raised.
goal. It's Delgado with his second.
Delaware three.
One, two, three.
Delaware!
Got the shot, and that one's in as well.
Welcome back to Under the Lights, driven by Chevy. Scott Klatzkin here with interim head coach Dennis Dottin-Carter. And amongst all the things that you've got to do this week and get ready for, number one on the priority list is Stony Brook. The Seawolves come into town with an undefeated 3-0 record in the CAA. They're a top 25 team now. Got in this week ranked number 24 after win against Rhode Island. Stony Brook has been a member of the CAA now for four seasons. This is the first time Delaware will be playing Stony Brook in a conference game. Is it odd to be playing a CAA game but not have any, you know, obviously a video of the team but not any against your team to kind of look at and have experience against?
Yeah, it is odd, you know, especially at this point, you know, when you've been in the same place for multiple years to not have played a team in the entire time. Again, this is our fourth season here. This will be the first time we play them. Mm-hmm. It's absolutely odd. You don't have a frame of reference on how they interact with each other on the field, how the coaches interact. All those visual things, they help you out during the game, and to be able to draw from that experience moving forward, you know, that's always good. So it is a weird situation, but again, every year we'll end up playing, this year we played a team who we hadn't played before in Wake Forest, you know, so it's not out of the realm of normalcy, I guess.
Yeah, but this is a Stony Brook team that is 4-2 on the season. They're 3-0 in conference play, like I said, a top 25 team. But you look at their offensive numbers. They're 10th in CAA in scoring. They're 11th in total yards, 11th in passing. They're not a high-powered offense, but their record is pretty good, and they find enough to win ball games.
Yeah. I mean, when you talk about their offense, you know, you look at their body of work. They scored 42 points in the number 2 ranked team in the country at Richmond. It was at Stony Brook, you know, so that kind of makes you feel good. It wasn't on the road because it's hard to win on the road. So if they're doing that on the road, they're pretty good, you know. But again, I mean, they've got a great, great team. You know, they are ranked for a reason. You watch them on film; they look like they should be ranked. Offensively, they have a number of skilled players who can beat you, who can create explosive plays. They have an offensive line who's a very, very good offensive line. And they have experienced players too. You know, they've got a group. You know, they have a couple transfers transfers that have come in, mm-hmm. but they've got a group that's been together as well, like our group has been together. So, you know, offensively, we know that they're going to be a force. They're going to try to run the ball. They kind of make their money being physical. They'll throw it if they need to, and you know, they'll be very similar to us. You know, I wouldn't be surprised if the game is over in about 2.5 hours.
Yeah, it's very similar offenses. Stacy Bettle is a guy coming off an injury a season ago. He scored 4 touchdowns in that game you talked about against Richmond, averaging 106 yards per game over the last 4 games. An experienced player, what does he do well?
I mean, he's a shifty back. He's got deceptive speed, meaning when you watch him, he doesn't look like he's running fast, but he's not going to get caught. Mm-hmm. He does a great job reading blocks. And, you know, I think one of the best compliments you can give a back in an offense like that is that he's patient. You know, he does a great job setting up his blocks. And I think, they've got a good coaching staff because all those guys, you know, they really do a good job running the football.
Defensively for Stony Brook, they're 2nd in the CAA in rush defense, a top 15 team in the nation in rush defense. But they haven't faced a offense running the football like Delaware yet. Do you feel like you can still attack them on the ground?
I mean, we're always going to feel like we can attack anybody. You know, in our DNA, we're going to believe that we can run the ball on anybody. We're going to believe we can stop the run against anybody. That's the attitude we're always going to take into the week of preparation, and we're going to take that into the game. So we are going to come out looking to run the football. We know that that's our strength, and you know, any other mistakes aside, we're going to throw the ball when we need to throw the football.
Now, Coach, it's been nice all week. Hopefully the weather holds up. It should on Saturday. It's a home game, the first of 2 in a row against Stony Brook. First time the Seawolves will come into Delaware Stadium. It should be exciting football. I know your team is ready to kind of put everything behind and just focus on Saturday's game, and I know all the fans should come out and see it.
I can't wait.
It'll be exciting. Best of luck to you in your debut as interim head coach here at Delaware. Go get them on Saturday. This has been another edition of Under the Lights, driven by Chevy. For interim head coach Dennis Dottin-Carter, I'm Scott Klatzkin. Thank you for watching, and as always, go Hens.